Thank you all for attending. I was only given two instructions today. One was to be on time, and the second was to be provocative. So why start out a talk being boring? This is going to be the best example of resilience I can show you today. But one of the things I've noticed in recent years is we tend to have a number of catchy words or phrases we've used to describe very complicated problems. And I think we tend to overuse those and somehow not fully understand what they mean, but it's easy to use. And one of those is resilience. It sort of rolls off the tongue. It's resilient. But in fact, there's a whole bunch of these words that I'm going to kind of hit on here briefly. And you've probably seen all these or heard all these many, many times. I don't want to step on too many toes, but we could say let's operationalize resilience for a new paradigm. Does that sound familiar? Anyway, so we can define resilience. You know, it's the ability to recover, to bounce back, to adjust, which is sort of on the left example of not very resilient from the Hurricane Sandy. But it's also not the strongest that survive necessarily, but it's those, and not the most intelligent, but those that are adapted or can adapt to change. And I think those are the challenges we're facing today. How do we adapt to changes that in the history of civilization we've never really had to worry about? There was a recent National Academy Committee on Community Environments and Resilience, and interestingly, we tend to think about the physical environment or maybe the natural environment, but there's also the financial, economic, human, governance, and so forth. So all those are important in terms of how they respond to stresses. Natural environments have done really well over the history of the Earth. Coastal environments, habitats, have dealt with hundreds of feet of sea level rise over millions of years, and they're still there, and they're still pretty healthy. So they do pretty well. Cities, however, don't. Today, if you look around the globe, 8 of the world's 10 largest cities are coastal, and at least 150 million people live within 3 feet of high tide. This is Miami. Most cities were not built with sea level in mind. And it's pretty easy to understand in that for the last roughly 7 or 8,000 years of Earth history, which is when essentially human civilization evolved, sea level has been relatively constant until the last century or so. And those cities are still being built. Between Miami and West Palm Beach, there's something like 50,000 condominium units being built virtually at sea level, underlain by limestone, which is like Swiss cheese. Water comes under it. None of them are taking sea level rise into account. And some of these are multi-million dollar condominiums. So the solution is to keep pumping the Atlantic Ocean out of Miami. There is some humor in that, actually. is that a strategy for resilience? We just pump forever. And this is a recent picture from the report that was talked about last night from the Union of Concerned Scientists. So this didn't get the pumps. And Miami, as we heard last night, and many other cities are starting to suffer more frequently from high tides. I just came across this, which I think has to do with sort of the human element. On the left, is an image of the number of people, adults, percentage, who think global warming will harm people in the U.S. And you can see most of the U.S. is in the sort of 40 to 50%, 50 to 60, maybe up to 70% of the people think global warming will harm people. And on the right is those who think it'll harm them personally. It's a different set of numbers. In fact, if you look, there's Miami. They actually think it's probably going to harm them personally. And there's Orange County, which doesn't think it's going to harm them personally. And I found this other map to superimpose on top of the one on the left. And I don't know what this map represents. Well, I actually do. Red and blue counties. And interestingly, of those areas that people think it's going to harm them in the U.S., they tend to be mostly blue. I'll just leave it at that. So from another viewpoint internationally, this is a recent paper by a guy from New South Wales that he talks about disposable infrastructure. And he makes the point that a lot of the original coastal development began as fishing villages, holiday homes, camping areas. They were all pretty self-sufficient in terms of infrastructure. They might have their own wells and septic systems and power supplies, but as those coastal villages expanded to cities, substantial infrastructure costs with sewage treatment plants, which are typically the lowest part in town, right at sea level. Power plants that are right on the coast because they need seawater for cooling. Very, very expensive systems that we're now beginning to have to come to grips with, particularly in California with roads and railroads and bridges and power plants and so forth. But he makes a point that's a little late for us, that when we develop on the coast, rather than making our infrastructure lines parallel to the coastline, whether it's a sewer line or a water line or whatever, so once sea level advances, we got to move everything back. We should make them perpendicular to the coast, so we just cut off the outer end each time we have a problem. But it's a little hard to go back today and rebuild the California coast. But one example of that, coming from a small sort of recreation home, is an area called Broad Beach in Malibu. People know about Broad Beach? There's a lot of people in the film industry that live there. This is what it looked like in 1972. I'd say those are generally pretty small beach houses. And if you look, the next picture is 2013, and you'll see that same gully on the background, but quite a bit different level of development. And as their beach sand supply has diminished from up coast, they've gone to temporary sandbags and now to revetment, with the idea of nourishing their beach with sand that they can't seem to find to bring onto their beach. But it's the example of going from little vacation homes to very, very expensive permanent homes. So a little perspective on California overall. We have some very different issues in California than many of those states like the Gulf Coast or the South Atlantic Coast, where we actually have sort of an organic shoreline. We may have mangroves or coral reefs, whatever, that actually can provide some resilience. But with most of the California coast being cliffed or bluffed, we don't have a lot of organic hope. So resilience begins to create some additional problems. And I'll make a distinction here between bluffs and beaches. About 650 of our 1,100 miles of coast consists of coastal bluffs. Beaches, maybe 300 or so miles, are low-lying areas. And those are subject to slightly different conditions, and resilience presents a different challenge. So this is that same picture expanded from Pacifica south of San Francisco. This would rank very low on a resilience scale. What do you do about this? Well, they demolished it. I guess that's a measure of resilience. You just take it off. I don't think that's how we tend to think of resilience. Another example some of you may know of, Isla Vista. Santa Barbara County, these were some student apartments in 1979 out on the bluffs. And if you look at these, which were built very close to the bluff edge before we start thinking about erosion, fast forward to 2013, you'll see on the left side, most of one apartment has now been taken down. Parts of two other ones have been taken down. And the decks that formerly were on the ones on the right have now been taken down. So maybe partial demolition is an example of resilience. I'm just asking that question. Moving from bluffs to beaches, this is Capitola, sort of a little vacation town in northern Monterey Bay, right on the water, virtually at sea level. This was a high tide and large waves a few years ago, so waves are coming over the seawall into downtown, into some of the restaurants. But a few years later, it's like this. I don't think they planned it for resilience, but I'd say it's pretty resilient. They, you know, clean out the sand out of the restaurants and scrape it off the streets, and we come back. This is short term. These kinds of events that may occur every several years. And actually in the background, you can see some pink and blue, they're actually condominiums on the sand. This is a close-up. These are the oldest condominiums on the California coast, called the Venetian Courts, built in 1928. But this is a typical winter there. This was taken a week ago. They take all their furniture out and remove their carpets and sort of start all over again. Again, I don't think they were built in 1928 for resilient, but because they're on the beach, they're relatively resilient, I guess. The one on the far left just went up on sale for $4.5 million. I think there's a sideline under the for sale that says on the sand, literally, on the sand. And then one was 180-degree ocean views. Getting closer to home, Mission Beach in San Diego, 1988. So if you just looked at this spot and said, wow, we got a wide beach in front of them, there's a seawall right in front of their houses and a sidewalk, safe place. And these houses are probably a couple $100,000. That was also supposed to be funny. But in fact, when we got high tides and storm waves, it came all the way across the beach, over that wall, and I'm always trying to figure out what these people are doing there. Are they trying to stop the water? Were they surprised? So this is what it looks like today. Is it resilient? Somewhat resilient, at least over the short term. The Embarcadero in San Francisco has become sort of ground zero for king tides, or these perigean high tides, where this is, you know, getting into the financial district and water's coming up onto the street. This is with no additional sea level rise. These are just very high tides. So I'll say resilient so far. And I want to make a distinction between short and long term. So we know these short term events because those are the ones we witness every winter or two, whether they're large El Nino events with elevated sea levels, whether they're combined occurrence of large waves, storm surges, high tides, or whether they're these very high several times a year but have been now called king tides, or long term, which are very different issues, sea level rise or land subsidence. And short term, Newport Bay, I think this is also some fairly expensive real estate, so fine at low tide. High tide is getting a little close. How much more sea level can they handle here? And then what happens when it gets that high? Do you build a wall? Another one at low tide, and most real estate agents, I hope I'm not stepping on anybody's toes, you like to show these houses at low tide. At high tide, maybe again, they're 6 inches. But again, these weren't built with sea level rise in mind. So we have a resilience question or problem here. Getting up to the sea level issue, this is the satellite altimetry, which is the most precise information we now have on global sea level rise. These were launched in 1993, so we now have 34 years of history. The rate now is about 3.4 millimeters per year, 13.4 inches per century. There's some uncertainty about where it's going from here, but most people that are dealing with climate change and sea level feel that this is going to increase. Uncertainty. Now, if I show this to my class, they don't know who this is. So you may recall, in a different context, I think it had to do with weapons of mass destruction. There were the known knowns, the known unknowns, and the unknown unknowns. And that really applies to sea level. We've got natural variations in climate, future greenhouse gas emissions, how much carbon is going to be released as permafrost thaws, what's the rate of melting of Greenland, and the big uncertainty, the biggest, is really what's happening in Antarctica. So I could ask this question, but in this audience I might get the right answer, so I may not. There's three big sort of deposits of ice on the planet, land-based ice. In the bottom left is in Patagonia, so these are the land-based glaciers, mountain glaciers. Anybody want to guess how much sea level rise total if we melt Patagonia, the Alps, the Andes, Alaska? I mean, how embarrassing, right, to give the wrong answer in front of everybody you know in the world.
Over 200 feet.
Over 200. This is just the mountain glaciers. Okay. Thanks for... It's about 2 feet. But close. Greenland. 6 feet. Pretty close. 24 feet. Antarctica. The woman who answered first is right now. Close to 200. About 190. So between them, we have about 216 feet of global sea level. And we could adjust those a little bit, but we feel pretty confident. That's not going to happen. Nobody thinks that's going to happen tomorrow or next year or this century or next century. But we don't need to melt at all. All we need is a couple of feet. And we can look around at those sea level rise viewers and see how your neighborhood or San Francisco Bay or Boston or Washington or Atlantic City or Miami or Guangzhou or Hong Kong or Singapore stack up. And there's a lot of places around the world that are within, you know, 10 feet of sea level. Earlier this year, Governor Brown had read a recent report, actually from last year, on recent research in Antarctica and looking more carefully at what seems to be going on there and how that might affect sea level, because there's, again, 190 feet of equivalent sea level rise sequestered in the ice of Antarctica. And to be clear, under perfectly natural conditions, all the ice on the planet has melted in the past. Call it hothouse Earth. We had fossils of palm trees and alligators in the Arctic. So under natural conditions, that's happened. We've also had a period called Snowball Earth, when we think the whole Earth, or most of it, was covered with ice. So those are natural extremes, but the thing is, there was no people here. Now we've got cities and development and so forth. So Governor Brown asked the Ocean Protection Council, the Ocean Sciences Trust, to do a study, and he wanted it in 2 months. Now, you know, nothing gets done in 2 months. But we did. We got this done in 2 months with some really smart people. For some reason, I still don't understand, I was asked to chair it. I think it was to keep the really smart people going. So we put that out. This is available online, and I think it's been really well received. But the big part of that was what's happening to these ice shelves surrounding these huge glaciers. And basically, those are the cork on the champagne bottle holding back those glaciers, and they're melting from below and they're melting from the surface. We just read about Larsen C breaking off, which isn't a big deal in some ways because it's not a lot of ice behind it. But this is what sort of changes our view. And what came out of that study was looking at projections into the future, partly tied into greenhouse gas emissions. And these are sort of on the left, sort of the midpoint, 50% probability. It may be higher or lower than that. And what you can see on the left is in 2030, half a foot, 6 inches. In 2050, close to a foot. By 2100, those RCPs are representative concentration pathways, which are different sort of thermal pictures depending on, in the low case, 2.6 if we cut out greenhouse gas emissions very quickly versus 8.5 where we just let it go. And you can see it begins to make a difference after about 2050. The second column is really, if we look at a 67% probability, it falls in there. And then we can go over here to the 1 in 20 or 1 in 200 chance. We can get up to pretty high numbers. So depending on your probability and your, you know, interest in gambling, we can get some pretty high numbers. So what are our options? Defend, accommodate, retreat. Cincinnatus, not far away. I personally think defend is what we've done historically, sort of short to intermediate term. Based on the Coastal Commission's policies of today, I really don't think we're going to build a whole lot more seawalls along the coast of California. Right now, 33% of the Southern California coast has been armored, and there are some impacts of that. Accommodate, there's a little different view shown last night of the Gulf Coast where you have things up on stilts, which we don't do in California. We have houseboats. This is the Embarcadero. We just kind of put up with it for a while. And then retreat. And there's a little bit of schizophrenia. This is UC Santa Barbara, Goleta Beach. They've sort of gone back and forth between two groups that are adamantly opposed to each other. Let's let it move back. Let's protect it because it's so important. No, we're going to move back. And they've gone from no rocks to rocks. And now they took out the rocks. I understand they're putting the rocks back in again. What can you say? So people are searching for those examples of resilience. I'm still searching for those. I think it's a great concept, but really hard to find places where you'd say people have worked out something that's resilient. And I'm going to end with one final slide, which is the ultimate resilient hotel in Korea. It's actually a hotel. I somehow don't think this would pass muster with the California Coastal Commission. Thank you.